Thank you, Neil. It's a pleasure and an honor to have you on Change I Am Possible, which is India's first future tech podcast. Neil Harbison is a British-born contemporary artist and cyborg activist, officially and legally recognized by our government as the first human cyborg. He has an antenna implanted in his skull, which allows him to perceive visible and invisible colors via audible vibrations in his skull, including infrared and ultraviolet. The implant also allows him to receive images, videos, music, or phone calls directly into his head via internet connection. So Neil, it's a pleasure and honor to have you on Change I Am Possible podcast. So this is something, obviously the introduction is something which I pulled off the net. How about you giving a brief introduction on who Mr. Neil Harbison is, and what's the story of the implant? How did you actually become the world's first cyborg?
Well, yeah, I have an antenna implanted in my head, and I created the antenna when I was a student at the university. I was studying music, and I was encouraged to use technology in music. So me and my friend created this system that basically transforms the vibration of color into a vibration that can be heard. So it's basically like a musical instrument, but instead of using the instrument as a tool, I was interested in transforming the musical instrument into a body part. So I thought that the best way would be to have it implanted in the body, so I would be able to hear the vibrations of color directly in the head. So it was an art project, and I see this now cyborg art, which is the art of creating new organs, new senses, and implanting them in the body.
So this was done in 2004, right? Correct me if I'm wrong. Right.
Yes.
So can you explain the backstory? Why was it implanted? I believe you have achromatopsia. It's when you're colorblind. What made you do that? You know, because that's being too bold. 2004, the technology was not so advanced to have implant. So you are like the first person in the world. Did you get a surgeon who readily was okay for doing something like that? What were the challenges you faced?
Well, I did it because I was in the context of art. In my university, we were doing experimental art, and we were talked about different artists that used their body, like performance artists, body art. So I saw that art can also be part of the body, or body can be art. So in that context, I didn't see it so strange to have the antenna implanted in my body. But then when I went out in the streets and I confronted society, then everything changed, because I realized that it was not only an art project, but a social project as well, or it has social consequences. Modifying oneself is not only an art movement, but also a philosophical question of what will we be in the future. If this becomes normalized, we might slowly merge more and more with technology, and we might become a new species. So it slowly became more than just an art project, and it became my life project, and also a social project. And I realized that my identity also slowly changed. I started feeling that the antenna was no longer something external, but I started identifying the antenna as a body part, and I stopped feeling the difference between the software and the brain. So I went into this world of technology without noticing it. It was a slow process. I started with art, and then suddenly I was in this context of technology and cyborgs and the future, which wasn't the initial context.
Right. You said you got into it in the context of art. Somehow, if you see, some of the craziest things in the world is introduced by artists. Like whatever we see now in movies right now has somehow been actually imagined by some of the top fiction writers, some brave directors who put that imagination into movies. So it's these artists who are brave to go out and do those things. I'm sure the way the technology is growing, you know, there are these brain computer interface, there are so many other ways where humans are being augmented. So I'm sure that in a couple of years, this could be a very very normal thing. But again, going back to the same question, how did you manage to convince a surgeon? How did you manage to convince yourself of putting an implant? Did you know pros and cons, or it was just because it was an art thing? It was a desire to be one of the world's first cyborgs. So what got you into it, and who did it, the surgeon and everything? What was the process?
The reason why I wanted to have it implanted, it was for practical reasons, because I realized that I really liked listening to the frequencies of color, and I wanted to feel this system not as a tool, but as an organ, and organs are permanent. So I tried to find a way of first like screwing it so it would be permanent, but it wasn't comfortable. So the best option was to find someone willing to drill my head and implant it inside my skull. So I went to the doctor, and the doctor said, no, we don't do this here and we won't do it. So if you want to do it, you'll have to convince a bioethical committee. So I went to a bioethical committee and I proposed the antenna surgery, because all new surgeries need to be accepted by bioethical committees, and this is a new surgery. So they said no to the surgery as well. The bioethical committee said it was not ethical to have this antenna implanted because it goes beyond human perception. So they don't find it ethical that you can go more, sense more than an eye, for example. So that was one of the reasons. The second reason, they didn't find it ethical because it's not a pre-existing body part. If it was an arm or a leg, they would find it ethical. But an antenna is not a traditionally human organ, so they didn't find it ethical. And the third reason is that they were worried about the image the hospital would have if someone came out with an antenna. But they helped me find a doctor willing to do the surgery anonymously, and then he did the surgery. And then my head was drilled, the antenna was placed inside. And then, yes, it has some risk. It could have gone wrong and it could have gone well. It's an art. I see it as an art that has a risk. There are many, many sports that have a risk. There are many cultural activities that have risk. We are surrounded by risk every day, and we are used to it. So there's also art that can have some risk, and this is one of them. And I was prepared for any outcome.
Right. So how has been the reaction of your friends, family, and society of you being so unique? And are you a musician? Because how do you decipher all those notes? How long did it take for you to get used to the sounds and recognizing those different colors?
Well, this in 2004 was extremely, extremely strange. So when my family and friends reacted in a very, well, some people laughed. They thought it was a joke. Other people thought it was stupid. Others thought it was ridiculous that I was making a fool of myself walking around with an antenna. I had all kinds of reaction, most of them bad or negative, or like, they had nothing to say sometimes. It was too strange in 2004. It was really, most people thought I was joking and it was a joke. And then slowly through the years, people started to think more about it, and started, some of them, to find it more interesting, or they had started having questions, which they didn't have in 2004. And then after some years, some people started to be interested. Maybe after 8 years, then I started to give talks about it. So it slowly became more and more interesting for people. So it's, social reaction has changed, and it keeps changing. So that's interesting to watch. And you were asking if I'm a musician. Yes, I am a musician, but I had to learn a completely new world. I mean, color is not like music. Hearing in color is much more microtonal. It has notes between notes. It took me like 3 years to really understand the whole spectrum, and I still have to learn new colors, because there's many, many colors like ultraviolets and infrareds that still have no name, so I have to name them.
Whatever people say, you have gone into the books of history. You are the world's first cyborg. The growth of technology is happening. I think it's inevitable that how we do makeup at this point of time, how we get out of home wearing these fancy clothes, I think in the near future, we all will have implants because, like Elon Musk said, I mean, you know, he's working on Neuralink to create a man-machine convergence is because of a reason, because he sees that how the growth of intelligent machines could be one of those reasons to make humans redundant. And the only way for humans to stay up to them would be to have these brain computer implants. You know, and it's not just that. There are so many people who are working on neuroprosthetics and exoskeletons. We humans are continuously being augmented, and I am super excited for where the technology is going. You have been one of the front runners, as you know, so you understand the art versus the marriage of technology. How do you think it has benefited you? What extra senses that you have gained which the other humans don't have at this point in time? So what do you think has been the benefit of having an implant at this point in time?
I think the biggest benefit is that technology can open up reality in ways that we've never perceived. So there are many elements now that are surrounding us, natural elements that we cannot sense because our biology is limited to our senses, biological senses. But then if you merge with technology, you can open up new senses and new doors of perception. And this can allow us to understand better reality that surrounds us. And it can allow us to sense nature in a deeper way and also connect to many other animals, because many of these senses are senses that other animals have. So it can actually break this bubble that we've created of isolation. Humans have isolated themselves from other animals and species. And by having senses that other animals have, we might actually be able to reconnect with other species and also with nature, because we'll be sensing nature in a much more profound way, and also connect to space, because we can also use these new organs and senses to connect to space and explore space without having to physically travel there. If there's senses or sensors in space, we can use the internet to connect our bodies to these sensors, and then we could be perceiving space and exploring space without having to physically go there. I call this becoming senstronauts. So it's basically having senses in space. In my case, my internet connection allows me to connect to NASA's International Space Station. And when I do this, I can sense colors from space, and I sense ultraviolets that I would never sense here in Earth.
Now, you said merge with tech. I think that is happening in ways which at times it's super exciting. And there is one side, it's super scary, you know, because first time in history of mankind, we are questioning things. We are questioning our reality. We are questioning how or what technology can do to us, because, you know, there is synthetic biology. We are trying to tinker with the source code of life. There is virtual reality where we are in the cusp of building a virtual world, which will soon be indistinguishable from physical reality. And then maybe we'll be asking questions on what reality actually is, because you could be redesigning reality as we know. I'm sure this is still a little ahead in the future, but we are at the cusp of becoming gods. We have not been such good decision makers or good holders of power. Where do you see the future of transplants going? Are we prepared to handle these? Because right now what you have is a technology or a tool which is in your body, which is giving you an extra sense where you can perceive the sound more than us humans can. Where do you think this technology is going, and what do you see human race look like in the next possibly a few decades with these technologies?
Yeah, first, I don't think we are slowly becoming gods, but I think we are slowly starting to collaborate with God, which is something that I think is very different, because we are not disqualifying our organic parts. We are not changing an organic part for a cybernetic one. We are actually just merging. We are valuing our organic body. We are never, at least here at the Cyber Foundation, we never talk bad about our organic and our organic senses and our organic body parts, but we like to open them up more by merging with technology. And this is always a collaboration between cybernetics and organisms. That's why the word cyborg, where the word cyborg comes from, you need cybernetics and an organism. Robotic is only technological. Cyborg needs the organic part. So we really value the organic part. And the future of our species, I think, will be much more diverse than we think, or than what we now call diversity is something that we'll have to get used to, the amount of diversity that will come in the future. I mean, we'll probably meet people with new organs or unique senses, and this will slowly become more and more normal. And also technology will become more organic. We'll soon be able to 3D print new organs with our own DNA. So instead of having a metallic antenna, it might be 100% organic with my own DNA. I might be able to, instead of use a chip, simply modify my genes so that I can perceive ultraviolet and infrared. So it will become, I think the future will become less robotic, like metallic. It will become more organic, and we will have a great diversity of humans and cyborgs and transspecies. Basically, transspecies is a word that is slowly becoming more and more normalized, which is that we are not only human, we can actually merge with other qualities of other species and become transspecies.
We will talk about your transspecies society and Cyber Foundation in a little while. You got into it too early, 2004, but right now the technology is growing. There's some, the implant technology is growing. But so what have you seen in your current, this thing, what are some of the exciting implants or which is augmenting human body? Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Well, there's Manel de Aguas, he has two fins here, like fish fins here, that allows him to feel the atmospheric pressure, the humidity and the temperature around him. So he feels the weather in a very precise way. There's also Moon Rivas. She has two implants in her feet that allow her to feel the seismic activity of the world. There's a boy called Kai Landre. He has a sensor that can allow him to feel the cosmic rays. So whenever there's a cosmic ray touching him, he can sense it. Now we are being touched by cosmic rays, but we don't feel it. So he can feel this. And there's a large number now of projects going on about extending our perception of reality. But I think the exciting thing will be like 3D printing all these organs, because now we're still making them by hand, most of them. And in the near future, 3D printers, I think, will allow us to create organs that are much more organic or biocompatible.
These implants obviously are not just giving you extra senses, but it's also adding to a person's more strength and things like that, like a neuroprosthetic. It does so much more. An exoskeleton does so much more than a human can. Now, do you see the possibility of somebody who's got a neuroprosthetic, you know, he gets an unfair advantage from others because he has an arm which could be made out of metal, it's connected to your brains, and it's super strong, he punches you, you're dead. So do you see that people who are getting these implants getting an unfair advantage? Are they going to be the first bunch of mutants who get superpower? Where do you see this going?
But yeah, we need to regulate this. The governments need to start talking about cyborg laws, cyborg rights. And one thing is that you might have an organ, but then you should be free to have this organ. But then you shouldn't be extremely free to use it in certain ways. Like if you, as you said, if you have a very strong arm, I think you are free to have a strong arm, but you're not free to use it in a harmful way. Or if you have a sense that allows you to look through walls, you might be able to have it, but you're not allowed to look through certain walls. And that's, governments need to regulate new laws regarding new senses. And this is something that some governments are starting to talk about, but it's still not as important as other matters right now. But yeah, in the future, there will be cyborg laws and rights, and these subjects will be talked about in governments.
Your antenna can help you understand a person's color. You have met celebrities from around the world, you know, I mean, from Prince Charles to... So how has that experience been, you know, and how do people... I mean, what's the difference between people? What have you got to know about, you know, when interacting with so many people and understanding how they... and what tone they have.
Well, yeah, the antenna allows me to feel the vibrations of color of anything in front of me. And what I really enjoy is listening to people's faces and vibrations of the face. And well, what really shocked me at the beginning is that people who say they're white, they're not white. And people who say they're black, they're not black. People who say they're white, they're actually very, very light orange. And people who say they're black, they're very, very dark orange. So humans are not black and white. We are all different shades of orange, and we vibrate in the same frequency, which is usually F sharp. So that's one of the things. And some people might have unusual vibrations, especially in the eyes, because the eyes can have many different vibrations. So I really enjoy listening to different faces, and some people might look different, but they might vibrate in a very similar way.
Would you like to talk about your organization, Cyborg Foundation and Transspecies Society? What do you guys do, and share a little detail on that?
Yeah, in the Cyborg Foundation, we create projects with universities usually, or people who might want to have a new organ or a new sense. And we also talk with governments, and we try to make technology available and as free as possible to everyone. So, and open source, we defend open source so that the codes are not closed, that they're open so that anyone can change the codes, the chips, and modify them. The Transspecies Society is an association of people who identify as transspecies, which is people who don't identify as being 100% human, either because they have a new organ or they've merged with a new sense, or because they feel in such a way and they want to have a new organ or a new sense. So yeah, there's two different things. One is that like more of a social group, and the other is more of activist type of foundation, is more activism.
Right. So what comes next for Neil Harbison? Are you looking at getting another implant, whether it's implants or whether it's non-invasive devices? There is so many exciting things happening. So what comes next for you?
Well, I already have another implant in my knee that allows me to sense the magnetic north. So it's like a compass that allows me to feel the north. So it gives you a sense of connection with the planet. And then the other project that I'm doing is an organ to sense the passage of time. So it's an organ for the sense of time. I've had it on my head for a while, but then it was removed because there was a problem. But it's basically a point of heat that takes 24 hours to go around the head. So depending on where I feel the heat, I know where the sun is shining. So if I feel it here, it means it's the sun is shining in London because my nose is London. If I feel it here, it's in Iceland, this is the US, and then it goes on and on. So India is around here. So I can feel where the sun is shining, and this allows me to feel the rotation of the Earth and feel the passage of time. So it's an organ for a sense that we already have. We all have a sense of time, but we don't have an organ for the sense of time. So I wanted to create an organ for the sense of time so that I can modify my perception of time. So if you wear it for several months, your brain gets used to it, and then it becomes almost subliminal. You don't feel it anymore, but you have the organ. And then if you modify the speed in which the point of heat goes around, then your sense of time is modified, and you can change your perception of time. You can make a situation last longer or go faster, or you can even travel in time if you make it spin several times. So basically an organ to take into practice that Einstein's time relativity theory, that time is relative. It's all about perception. So it's a way of creating time illusions in the same way that we can create optical illusions because we have an organ for sight. We can create time illusions if we have an organ for time. And that's my main focus now is time.
Thank you, Neil. It was a pleasure and honor to talk to you and understand from you about who you are, what you're doing. And I am super excited about where the technology is going. We have these technologies, like tools like virtual reality, since I'm invested in for a long time. I feel that, you know, we might get into that world where we don't really need to do anything, you know, because we could have these virtual avatars where we could, you know, or virtual avatars could be whoever we choose to be. It could have 5 hands, 10 hands, like, you know, there are a lot of these Indian gods who have like so many hands and so many powers. So we are getting into an exciting space with, you know, this convergence of technology and human beings. All technology is like a double-edged sword, you know, I mean, because it's got its pros and it's got its cons, you know, I mean, how we leverage it, you know, for whether it's a good for a bad, whether it's personal augmentation, the augmentation is for a good or bad, will chart the future ahead. You mentioned about how these implants could possibly give you like unfair advantage, you know, and there are regulatory bodies who are trying to find ways where maybe, okay, this shouldn't be used for bad, you know, but who is going to stop? Because I think the world is moving way too fast, way too soon. And we need to, I think, slow down and understand that these tools are giving us so much power and so much potential. And we need to, like, really look at it. And I hope that there is a body that comes in. And it's an exciting space because we all are gonna have superhuman powers in another few decades. Maybe my son, when he, you know, or maybe my son's son could, you know, go out every day in a virtual world, possibly looking like someone else. And also, we're going in an exciting space. So I am really excited about the future. Thank you for being part of Change I Am Possible podcast. Thanks a lot, Neil. Really appreciate this. Yeah. And to my listeners, if you like what you see in here, please press the subscribe button. Until next time, see you guys. Bye-bye. Thank you.